So analogous to thinking about ADSP for sort of large studies, people also ask me, in terms of setting up a core and, you know, doing large scale sequencing, what do I do? And I say, well, just do what CIDR does. Not endorsing them, of course. So I send people here and they can look and see the kinds of things CIDR does and the way they interact with dbGaP. And I think they're a really good example of an institution that does a lot of interaction. So without further ado, here's Kim Doheny.
Thank you, everyone. First, I just want to thank Mike Fiello and everybody at dbGaP for the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here. I think I represent a group that's, I do represent a group that's older than dbGaP. Sounds like I'm the first one today. But CIDR recently had its 20th anniversary, and we've been working with dbGaP for its entire 10 years, so it's really a pleasure to be here today. So the Center for Inherited Disease Research, I'm going to focus on what I call the CIDR program today, which is our activities, which are supported through a trans-NIH contract. We're basically a center that is set up to provide researchers access to key genomic resources, and we have been around for the past 20 years. The contract is a trans-NIH contract to Johns Hopkins University, and we as Phoenix Toolkit are glad to announce that we recently got renewed, competitively renewed, and will be funded through 2023. We're excited about that. Over the years, 13 different NIH institutes have supported the CIDR program, and we're currently supported by 10 NIH institutes. In total, we have released data supported by this NIH contract on 423 studies, starting with linkage studies in the 90s and moving on to candidate gene studies, fine mapping studies, GWAS studies, and in the most recent 5 years, sequencing studies. We've released data on almost 1 million samples. I'm watching this closely to see when we tick over that 1 million mark. And we have been able to locate about 1,200 publications related to studies which the data was generated at our center. We represent a very diverse set of phenotypes because of the way we are sponsored by many, many NIH institutes. So over 200 phenotypes are represented by our studies. And we also support a large number of investigators, over 300 unique investigators located worldwide. All of the NIH contract-funded studies do have to have, obviously, an NIH grant collaborator, but we have many sites that are located worldwide. So just to start and look back in history a little bit about where we started in all this fun with the GWAS era, it was with Dr. Ho's very lucky study, which was published in 2005, where they found a really large signal with 96 cases and 50 controls, 116,000 SNP polymorphisms. So this really got the whole genetics community super excited about genome-wide association studies. And it's really what started us all down this path. And then kind of the next player that I think of when I'm looking back is GAIN. So the Genetic Association Information Network was a public-private partnership. And it was really the big first group of studies which were approached through GWAS methods. And this GAIN study was really the first time when dbGaP staff were involved in these studies and started on the whole process of figuring out how to deal with this data, how to QC this data. So CIDR actually provided the first GWAS data set for the first dbGaP study. Very proud of that. So study one, version one, which was the ARID study, which Mike mentioned already. So the age-related eye disease study funded, of course, by NEI, since they had this exciting result so early on. And that was released in June of 2007. It really a pleasure to work with everyone at dbGaP in starting this new initiative, which was so important to support the brand new data sharing policy, which had come out of NIH. I just want to mention, I don't have a separate acknowledgement slide at the end, but the people that I've worked with very closely have been Mike Fiello, Justin Pashal, Laura Ziabari, and then on my CIDR side, our review administrator at the time was Jerry Roberts, and our senior statistical geneticist, Elizabeth Pugh, were all very key in getting everything working for how we interact with dbGaP. So the CIDR program, as the data sharing policies came out, our funding representatives, which we call their Board of Governors, decided that all GWAS studies which came through the CIDR program would be shared through dbGaP with very few minor exceptions allowable, and that the cost for the assistance that would be provided to the investigators for data cleaning and posting would be included in our fees for a GWAS study. So it was really all rolled together into a package. And we developed a workflow, which I think is what Ben was referring to mostly. Basically, a standardized workflow, which allows the funding institutes to verify institutional certification before we start any molecular work. And then, again, that allows us allows the institute to verify completion of the phenotype submission to dbGaP before we release data to the investigators. So we do have a way to kind of control the fact that the investigators are sharing their data and that they share it in a timely manner. The genotyping data for GWAS studies coming through the CIDR program are released simultaneously to both the PI and MCBI. And then originally there was a parallel data cleaning process which went on with dbGaP staff and the PI groups, which was facilitated by my group at CIDR. And as we all have mentioned, no one could predict how fast and furiously this data would come. So I think we all quickly got somewhat overwhelmed trying to do this very careful parallel process. But we did spend a lot of time developing standards. And then along came a lot of other large GWAS consortia, such as Geneva, Emerge, Garnet, all of which CIDR were involved in generating genotyping data sets for. And these consortia had a collaboration data coordinating centers based at the University of Washington Department of Biostatistics, led by Bruce Weir and Kathy Lorry. We had a wonderful relationship with this group at the University of Washington, very similar viewpoints about the value of standardization and quality control. And actually, Terry Manolio at NHGRI suggested that we should start working together. So beyond working as part of these consortia, but that the CIDR program and the UW Genetics Coordinating Center should join together and collaborate to really strengthen how these GWAS data sets would be most useful to the community. So we did that, and we began a formal collaboration with them in the summer of 2011. And since then, all the GWAS studies coming through the CIDR program, once we finish our data, basically kind of raw level data review, data QC at CIDR, the data is released to the PI, NCBI, and the University of Washington Genetics Coordinating Center. And the group out in the University of Washington does all the data cleaning, extensive filter recommendations, both in the sample and the SNP level, and generates a data cleaning report, which is extremely detailed and really has set a standard in the field, going all the way to pre-compute to make sure there aren't any artifacts in the data. And then they also provide data posting assistance imputation, which is wonderful. So most of the imputed data, a lot of the imputed data sets in dbGaP are from our program, QC on the imputed data and posting of that data as well. So just to talk a little bit about quality, so through this whole kind of history, which I've just described to you, a series of papers came out describing best practices for the generation and quality control of GWAS data, including the initial publication coming out of the Geneva Consortium led by Kathy Lorry, Quality Control and Quality Assurance in Genotypic Data for GWAS Studies, then looking at working mostly with the Emerge Network, really looking at some of the details needed to pay attention to when you're merging data, different data sets to do a mega analysis with GWAS data, and which is necessary when you're using a biorepository design where you're using controls where you have to go back to the raw data across studies. And then a paper looking at imputation and quality control steps when you're combining multiple GWAS data sets. And then the final paper looking at kind of the pitfalls and standards and best practices around using previously genotyped controls, which is obviously a really big way that the dbGaP is used by different investigators. At this point, many investigators will do a case-only study right now and get their controls and download them off dbGaP. So 10 years later, since we started, as of June 2017, there's been 99 studies which have been posted and are available with data generated CIDR. The last one was one of the lung cancer studies from the OncoArray Consortium. So we started at study PHS1, and the most recent one is study 1273. So there's been a lot of work done in the last 10 years. The CIDR program, 99 studies, encompass about 485,000 samples. So I didn't know how many total were in there, but I'm pleased to see that we're representing about a third of the total samples, about 25% of the overall GWAS studies, and about 35% of the large GWAS studies. And I think, just a quick shout out to publications, which of course we're all interested in. By searching PHS numbers related to our studies, we recently identified about 100 publications which have used downloaded dbGaP data sets generated at CIDR. And looks like I am done. I'm going to give a blurb about, so we recently, CIDR recently moved to the East Baltimore campus. We're now joined with other research and clinical genomics groups to form a group, kind of a super group called Johns Hopkins Genomics. All the individual units still exist. So we have a really big staff of very diverse genomic expertise at this point for both clinical and research work, and we have a beautiful new building on the East Baltimore campus. So come see us, talk to me if you have needs. Thank you.
Any questions from the audience?
So two quick things. Kim tricked me because I was walking up to her. She went to her last slide and then backed up. And showed her other slides, which I've never seen anybody do. Also, I would like to, I'm not making this up when I say, actually, me on the behalf of my group will be applying for access to the ARENS dataset at 4 o'clock today. So if members of the DAC are here, just remember that. Thank you, Kim.